Let us begin.
Yes. Mm?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
National dishes also, no, they are.
My name is Joseph Weil. I am the president of the European University Institute, and I welcome you all on behalf of the European University Institute. When we decided to invite three distinguished, experienced, and visionary European politicians and leaders to draft a new Schuman declaration, it was because we believed that the challenges that Europe faces today, 65 years after the first Schuman declaration, are no less grave, are no less serious. And I can add that sometimes it's easier to create something new than to fix something that is already existing. We are, of course, well aware that the original Schuman Declaration, when it was pronounced, was a political statement already negotiated and agreed. But what you have to imagine is the initial draft of the first Schuman Declaration. Its boldness, its willingness to propose things that at first sight might have seemed politically challenging or even unrealist, the willingness to lead, and not just by public opinion polls, and the great responsibility of the authors. And I must commend the courage of Giuliano Amato, Elisabeth Guigou, and Vaira Vicker Freiberger in accepting to put their name and associate themselves to this document, which is so evocative in terms of its history. I also want to introduce our commentators, Danuta Maria Hubner, the chair of the Constitutional Affairs Committee of the European Parliament, President Giorgio Napolitano, Professor Calypso Nikolaidis, Professor of International Relations at Oxford, our very own Premslo Palka, a researcher in our Department of Law, Romana Prodi, needs nothing else, and former President of Slovenia, Danilo Turk. The way we will proceed is as follows. I will invite President Vika Freiberger to read the document entitled Towards a New Schuman Declaration. And then we will have a first round of our commentators who will pose questions to the authors, challenging questions, critical questions on the text that is being presented, and will engage in a dialogue with them, which I will moderate. And then we will have a second round of our commentators in which they will be able to express their views if they were drafting what they might have put in that is not to be found in the draft that is before us. If we have time, we might be able also to take some questions from our audience. So it's my honor to invite President Vika Freiberger to read the document Towards a New Schuman Declaration. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear fellow Europeans. We are reading a text which is called Towards a New Schuman Declaration. Even at a time of crisis, one can neither forget nor overstate the fundamental contribution of the European construct in the destiny of our continent over the last six decades. In several respects, the successes of Europe may have exceeded the boldest expectations of its visionary founders. What seemed at the time no more than a dream, making war among the member states of the Union unthinkable, became an unquestionable reality. And though not perfect, Europe was transformed so that citizens, as well as goods, services, and capital, could move freely in a vast common marketplace, which for decades was an engine of prosperity in an area committed to social justice, solidarity, and ecological responsibility. The appeal of Europe was not merely economic. The underlying values of human rights, the rule of law, and democracy provided an inspiration and catalyst for the democratic transformation of many of the member states which joined an enlarging union. At its best, the union represented the promise of a better future for all. Now the circumstance of Europe has changed. We are witnessing today a pervasive sense of insecurity among European citizens. There's the obvious and immediate sense of economic insecurity, both private and collective. There is coupled with a concomitant concern of the ability of our societies to retain their commitment to an order which guarantees not only individual prosperity, but a life of dignity and social justice for all. Something as fundamental as energy supply, the ability to keep our homes warm and our factories humming, has become a source of anxiety. A changing geopolitics, with different kinds of armed conflicts ranging on the borders of and in close vicinity to Europe, has made the issue of external defense and internal security a matter of real concern to many. At a deeper level, the specific cultural and political identity of national societies is perceived as being threatened. For many, this is associated, rightly or wrongly, with the phenomenon of immigration, both internal and external. Finally, there are growing doubts about the Union itself, notably the ability of our institutions to reflect and respond to the desires and wishes of the very citizens they are designed democratically to serve. There has been a worrying disengagement of a large number of citizens from the process of European integration. The appeal of the European dream has weakened considerably. The challenge before Europe is to respond to these insecurities and once again to become the source of hope in a better and safer future. It must convincingly demonstrate that for the most of these issues, Europe, united in solidarity, offers the best and in some cases the only effective answer. As in the past, this will require bold leadership, transcending the immediate daily concerns of our political life and guided by a vision of and a belief in a better European future. There is not a single plan which can redress these challenges overnight, but we believe decisive action in several key domains could constitute a platform for the re-transformation of Europe and the re-engagement of its citizens. First, the policies put in place and the instruments developed in response to the current crisis seem to be finally beginning to produce the hoped-for effects in terms of growth. But the disparity between the monetary and fiscal toolkit of Europe has to be faced unflinchingly, and its resolution has to be part of any medium and long-term strategy for a credible economic future for Europe. The resources of the Union are clearly incommensurate with its responsibilities. However, sufficient resources are already available to remedy what a great number of Europeans have suffered as the main injury produced by the prolonged economic and financial crisis, namely the reduction both of jobs and of the level of protection and essential social rights. The Union, still proud of its welfare culture and institutions, should set a minimum threshold for social and sanitary protection and allocate a new fund for subsidiary interventions whenever in a member state the threshold cannot be respected. Secondly, likewise, the priorities in the matter in which the Union spends the resources have to be re-examined. Historically, Europe undertook, justifiably at the time, a major commitment to the agricultural sector. Despite the successive reforms of the CAP, which reduced significantly the European resources dedicated to agriculture, this sector still attracts a large portion of the Union budget. That commitment should not be abandoned altogether, but one would hope that it would be more equally distributed. The commitment should not be therefore abandoned. But the reality of the lives of most citizens is urban. We are now all city dwellers. A shift of resources to a common urban policy, in which mayors could play an important role, with urban renewal projects contributing to growth and employment, as well as climate control, should be considered a priority in a reviving Europe. Third, moving decisively to establish an energy union which would rationalize the production, procurement, and distribution of energy for Europe as a whole could provide a level of high energy security for all, with best practices of conservation, climate control, renewability, and sustainability. Once considered as the core of national sovereignty, it has become today palpably apparent that no single member state has on its own the capacity to guarantee the defense and security of its citizens in the face of potential external threats or the challenge of terrorism, which recognizes no national boundaries. National sovereignty in this area is an illusion. A European defense union in which the defense and security capabilities, expenditures, and procurement would be pooled can no longer be rejected on the basis of this illusory notion of sovereignty. Such a Europe would both enhance the contribution, its contribution to and its voice within NATO, and more effectively and justly be able to meet the challenges of extremist terrorism. Furthermore, in order to meet such challenges, pooling national resources of intelligence and investigation would raise the efficiency of preventive activities and give the citizens a welcome sense of enhanced security. Our understanding of European citizenship must undergo a radical shift. Mobility should remain one of the fundamental principles of the European common space, but it alone cannot constitute the core of European citizenship. Veritable citizenship is not about moving, it's about the ability of citizens to own the polity, to gain a real sense of their preferences as expressed through the political process and have a meaningful and decisive impact that governs Europe and how Europe is governed. One way of doing this would be to change the political process so that election time, citizens are given meaningful political choices as regards the policies to be pursued by the Union, and those who govern at the European level are meaningfully accountable to their electors. The demographics of Europe are such that a policy of legal and well-regulated immigration is and will remain indispensable for its future. The reality of free movement within Europe makes the Union necessary for an effective regulation of immigration, which European citizens legitimately expect. The premise of any such policy is that Europe should be a home to newcomers, but those in turn must make Europe and its value their home. The responsibility of dealing with illegal immigration and with asylum seekers in a manner consistent with our belief in the inviolability of human dignity should not be shouldered by the gateway member states all alone. 65 years ago, Robert Schuman wrote that concrete achievements were needed to create solidarity among Europeans and upon this basis to build Europe. Today, concrete achievements are equally needed to restore solidarity among Europeans and open, and upon this basis, to revitalize our common Europe. Giuliano Amato, Elisabeth Guigou, and Vairovic Freiberg.
Thank you very much. And I would like now to invite President Giorgio Napolitano to make the first comment or pose the first question to the authors.
Thank you for the invitation. And first of all, congratulations to the authors of this document. Very ambitious declaration. Also in reference to the Schuman Declaration. And at the same time, I think it provides measured and valuable answers. There is a perfect equilibrium between the appreciation of the extraordinary achievements of the construction of Europe, which is a heritage of values that have been stated and of objectives that have been achieved, and no demagogic campaign can reduce those values. And at the same time, you acknowledge clearly and firmly the current situation, which has changed so considerably since, as compared to the 1950s. I would just like to ask whether you have not perhaps too much expanded the notion of security, putting under the heading of security rather different situations of opinion and of policies, and which hark back to different kind of responsibilities. Because when we speak of a loss of security amongst the citizens as far as external defense and internal security, we know what this is about, and we also know what responsibilities we are calling upon here. Essentially, these are the responsibilities of the states and of the European Union institutions. So when we speak of the loss of security in our energy supply, we know we are targeting very clearly the origins of this fact, and this relates to the decisions we need to take. But I do find it's rather tricky instead to talk about insecurity when we're talking about an improvement of life conditions, of living conditions, of social improvement, I'm not really convinced by the notion that the union must guarantee individual prosperity and social justice, because this could possibly encourage the rather passive attitude of expectations on the part of the citizens that these assets will be guaranteed from above. We are in the face of a situation which must instead call upon the responsibility of a wide variety of subjects. And also, when we talk about a loss of the security of national identity, and we're speaking about a national identity that feels threatened, especially by immigration or migrations, here we're up against something very serious that has developed over the past 10 years, or not much more. The historical cultural commitment, our collective commitment, which aimed to strengthen the self-awareness of the European identity, well, here we are evoking the responsibility of our cultural sphere and also of our political parties and of our citizens. I will stop at that right now. There is a further consideration, but I won't make it. It's a consideration that hasn't got that much to do with the situation we're in this afternoon. Someone might say that there are no concrete proposals. That is not true, because there is the basis for a lot of concrete action and concrete proposals on the part of the European, or the reference to the defense. And I'm also referring to a European regulation on migration policies, or what was defined here as the need to have a social and health common social and healthcare threshold. So there's a lot actually already here in terms of concrete proposals. But there is also, apart from your private effort at writing this declaration, there are public attempts going on in Brussels aimed at rewriting or updating the important of the five presidents, called Completing the Economic and Political Union. So that document is on another plane, but I think that this document of yours is also an appreciable contribution.
What to?
I have
Yes.
Well, first of all, I have to say that the three of us, Elizabeth, Vaira, and myself, have to express their gratitude to Joseph Weiler, who convened us around this mission. And I don't know whether in the official copy of this document you formally appear as the secretary to the three of us.
In tiny letters,
which is a sort of nice understatement of the role you have played in the preparation of this document. Well, let me say to President Napolitano that he is obviously right when he points at the difference between security as interest connected to fighting external and internal military or violent threats. This is different from other securities that we have somehow put under the same umbrella, and also implies different actions. This is something that we can only agree with. But our main purpose was to, going back the Schuman Declaration, point at what has happened against his vision of the future. He had written 65 years ago that we could build Europe step after step as long as solidarity is being formed among Europeans and between the Europeans and the construction of Europe. A process that has gone on for years and that has been replaced recently by a sort of opposite process leading to more hostility, diffidence, searching for self-defense inside national walls and borders by several Europeans. Why? Now, our common answer was because they feel insecure on several fronts, and they don't trust Europe. Europe does not give them sufficient security on several matters. External defense, I must say, Romano, you said previously in the other debate that when you speak of peace, the students you are talking to are not convinced. What has peace to do with their current problems? Well, go to her country, and you will know, in the Baltic countries, nowadays, there is a lack of security in relation to external possible threats. And of course, what has happened in Paris, internal threats, but insecurity has also to do with economic life, with jobs, with losing my sanitary protection. What happens to me if I happen to be in Greece, jobless, and I fall sick? I feel insecure. So we used this common denominator, insecurity, to find European responses that by responding to insecurity could restore confidence. And that's why we picked these areas, these proposals in relation to common defense, pooling investigation and intelligence, a common fund, subsidiary of course, but giving a minimum threshold of social protection when needed, and so on and so forth. This is the sense, thinking of the European citizen who feel insecure on several fronts. We think that responding to this by Europe might be essential for it to restore solidarity.
Thank you. And I would like to turn to President Danilo Turk to pose the next question to the authors.
Thank you, Professor Weiler. Thank you for the initiative and an excellent document which was presented to us today. I think it is really very well drafted and very inspiring. Now, I received this declaration or the document leading towards a new Schuman declaration yesterday. And while expecting the text, I of course read the original Schuman declaration and tried to figure out what should be the criteria upon which I will make my position on the new document. And in the old Schuman declaration, of course, we find these two guiding ideas, which I believe are relevant, are quite well reflected in the document that we have received today. First, a call for a creative effort proportionate to dangers, and I think that this document in fact does try to address all the questions in a creative spirit. And secondly, the realization that things cannot be done at once according to a single plan.
So again, disaggregation into several specific proposals. Now, I do not wish to comment at this point all aspects of the text, but I would like to especially emphasize, and this brings me to what President Napolitano and Prime Minister Amato were speaking about, the idea which is very precisely defined here to reform the common agricultural policy and to create a common urban policy. I find this idea extremely interesting and potentially very useful because it does respond to the questions of security or the feelings of insecurity which are so typical for Europe today. Now, I think that this proposal requires further discussion, and maybe we shall hear about it from experienced people who were in the Commission and have discussed the questions of common agricultural policy and know how a common urban policy can help to bring the what is called European social model to a new level and to respond also to challenges of global warming and all other challenges of our time. So this is my question also to the authors, if they would want to say something more about this proposal, which I, as I said, find very interesting, especially if one compares it with the part of the declaration which deals with monetary and fiscal questions, where there is a recognition that these questions have to be unflinchingly approached. Now, I have a feeling that they were quite carefully approached in the document, and I believe that part of the answer to the question of strengthening the fiscal instruments has to do with resources and also with the idea of common urban policy. So whatever we can learn from the background, from how the text was drafted on this, would be useful. And the other question, which I would really like to put in a very succinct manner, relates to common foreign policy. Now, there are references to security policy, to strengthening of security capacity, and all this is, I think, very well and very, very well argued in the document. But then again, these are proposals which will take time. And the world is changing these days rapidly. European Union is placed in a geographic location which is practically overwhelmed by crisis in the neighborhood. I mean, from Western Sahara to Eastern Ukraine, there is a huge crisis area. And the question of definition of European Union in relation to major crisis areas and major powers of today is an important question. This cannot wait. I can imagine that there were good reasons not to enter into this area, again in the spirit of Schuman declaration that one should not strive to have everything done at once and to avoid unrealistic ambitions. But I believe that the discussion today could be useful if we could elucidate a little bit about what we want to see as European Union, a major player in global politics. These are my questions.
President Vika Freiberger.
I would like first to point out that there's naturally a great deal that we haven't said and have not included in the report that we very much would have liked to add, as well as to clarify, so that if it raises questions in your mind about what else should be done, we'll be more than delighted, because we ourselves, I think, had a number of things that to get agreement between even three people, of course, is difficult, and I think President Napolitano pointed out that many efforts have been done, after all, in the past 65 years, and in a democracy, it is not always easy to get consensus and to get things moving. But the point is that in a democracy and in a solidarity movement such as the European Union, citizens can get impatient. Citizens need to have a clear vision of where it is that we're going. I think Schuman was very modest in his declaration, and this one is rather more ambitious even for all the things it has omitted. He emphasized the fact that things need to be done, They need to be done together. That the old model that had forever prevailed of zero-sum games of one nation state another, or one prince against another, or even three popes against each other, should be abandoned, and that the idea of win-win situations, actually, of course, he didn't use this game theory terminology, but that's really what he meant, is that having situations where clearly both sides would have something to gain, could mobilize them for a common effort. And this is more true than ever. I'd like to make a small comment on President Napolitano's comment about security. Here again, we mentioned very broadly internal and external security. I think the very danger and threat that we are facing has multiplied. It's taken on a sort of hydra kind of aspect with many different heads. And any day a new form of it appears. We can think of cyber attacks that can destroy banks and court records and country records. A teenager, 13 years old, somewhere hacking away in his basement, could do that sort of harm. We have the danger that's posed by terrorists, which by definition is unpredictable, but we do have to look for its root causes. Wars are no longer fought in the Napoleonic fashion, where you have the troops and allies of Napoleon on one side and of Wellington on the other. Even since the Second World War, we have engaged into different kinds of warfare. There's been guerrilla warfare. Now we have entered hybrid warfare. There are mass uprisings that are changing regimes in a great many countries with increasing frequency, much more so than used to be the case. Energy and ordinary commodities on which we depend. Today it is fossil fuels, tomorrow it might be water. Commodities that are essential to our lives can become tools of political manipulation and of blackmail and of pressure and of undesirable pressure that amounts to the same thing as being conquered by somebody who does not have the same convictions as you do. So that we have organized crime that has by now already taken over a number of dysfunctional states. At last count, I was told there are 40 states where the state is no longer the main agent of established order, but where organized crime or revolutionary groups are actually the ones who are in power. So that the very concept of the nation state is being weakened, and everything that we've built up so far has been based on that. So that as far as dangers go, alas, they are much broader than what we very briefly alluded to in our report.
Thank you. Professor Kalypso-Nikolaidis.
Joseph Giuliano, first of all, I'd like to say that I think you could not be better served than by Vaira's telling of the text. Some of you might know that she's back home famous for singing beautiful Latvian ballads. So Vaira's voice for your inspiring words. And indeed, how do we thank you for having engaged all of us to concentrate the mind on the fate of our small continent? Well, perhaps to take you, first of all, at your succinct and inspiring words. And in this spirit, my first and most naive question would be, what is in a name, Schuman? The Schuman Declaration. What is your coal and steel in this declaration? To pick up on Danilo, is it, for instance, grids? Urban, your coal and steel. Is it, for instance, grids, urban grids, continental grids that bring us together? What is your specific coal and steel? But then I thought, well, maybe...
So why don't we let them answer and then I come back to you.
Okay.
So Giuliano and then... President Victor Freiberger, well, what is your coal and steel?
Calypso, this was my first reaction to the proposal by Joe. Why don't we write a sort of second? And my immediate answer was, but what can we pull together? Because he had steel and coal, and he could write that putting steel and coal together, we could eliminate the reasons of wars of which French and Germans were the first victims. It is such a great opening for the future of Europe. He named it the messianic message of the founding fathers, which has gone lost. We can't imagine of producing a new message emotionally so strong and pervasive as this one. So we had to invent something else. We are perfectly aware that when we, people like the two of us, discuss about the future of Europe, we are using abstract processes that we have to go through. The great leap forward, a deeper integration, passing from top down to bottom up democracy, to empower our citizens, etc. If we write things like this here, the citizen, I'm sorry, doesn't feel involved. So we wanted, what should we give now? I can repeat what I said. Europe can give something that responds to the basic needs nowadays of our citizens, that restoring security, confidence, and hope for the future. And the point is whether our proposals go correctly toward these feeling that has been spreading around. If I tell you that Europe can prevent what happened in Paris, that you are safer in your city because Europe is doing something, is preventing these things from happening. If you feel the need of feeling safer in the city where you live, and Europe is entering there with what Europe can do, and so on and so forth. But there is no simple steel and coal today that I can sell to my fellow citizens.
President Vika Freiberg.
I would suggest that we do have certain first steps that would help an awful lot to go in the same direction. And I would say that this is to deal with money. Not steel, not coal, not commodities, but money and the way we handle it. We have now a common monetary policy. We have the euro. But we don't have fiscal policies that are coordinated and coherent. There's no way of controlling if there's a lack of fiscal responsibility. There's no way of controlling whether a country actually cheats the rest of its fellow citizens or the rest of its fellow Europeans in presenting its accounts and in milking the common fund that we have all put together. This is something that can be, I think, relatively easy remedied. It's reasonably concrete, and both country budgets and individual family budgets should be able to see some effects of it in a reasonably foreseeable and visible time.
A quick follow-up.
Well, actually, I found this response interesting because on one hand, Giuliano, it's not so simple. On the other hand, Vaira, money. But isn't money the culprit? And this leads me to the question I really wanted to ask Joseph, which is really what kind of declaration do you want, do we want this one to be? Because what is the raison d'être, as it were? You know, wouldn't you agree with me that all successful declarations link past, present, future, but at the same time, they emphasize one. So the question becomes, is the declaration mostly a kind of phoenix declaration about the past, that we've made a mess of it in Europe, and we, our atonement, are making a diagnosis. We've made the mess, but we can be reborn from our ashes. Or is it a declaration really more about the future? To pick up from Joseph's work, you know, a missionary declaration, a declaration that says the owl of history has landed, we can go to this line of progress, here is the vision, or we can regress, and here is the horizon, and we draw it. And you do it beautifully in the declaration by calling for Europe united in solidarity and in safety. But is that the core? Is that the core message? Or indeed, is it really more of a manifesto declaration, a declaration really about the here and now, the present, the to-do list? And indeed, there again, you do it for us, including, as Danilo was picking up and I picked up too also, an urban, common urban a policy. That is a very interesting and creative. But the question becomes, you know, if we go back to Schuman, he managed to do the three of them. At least we can say that ex post facto. Actually, he really cared about French balance of account balance. But what about you? What is your intent? What is your core? Three emphasis will guarantee more ownership by future generations, for whom Schuman, after all, is more than a father, a grandfather.
So first of all, I would dispute the putting all the blame on the elites and on those who lead for obvious reasons, but also because if I were to choose among those responsible, I would point to the bankers rather than to the politicians. Actually, my belief is that we're all responsible. And that's the whole point of democracy. If there's not a minimal sense of involvement, that we're all in this boat together, and that boat is no longer my village, or my region, Montpellier, as they used to say, and similarly in my country, when we said Montpellier, we meant the very region, very narrow region around me. Now we're talking about this whole community of nations that have chosen voluntarily, without wars, without occupations, without threats of any kind, voluntarily have knocked on the door, have entered it and been accepted in this common space. And we are in a way, I think if I would prioritize what we're trying to do, we're saying, dear Europeans, please do not dismiss everything that has been achieved in the last 65 years. It started out with a very modest, plain, simple, concrete recommendation which had huge implications for the future, but it mobilized, yes, first the politicians and then, but also the businessmen and the rest of the communities. And it grew, and we know very well that by the time the Soviet Union collapsed, the countries that were knocking at the doors of the European Union were countries that were attracted by its values, most of all by its values of justice, of stability, of accountability, and of fairness of some sort, which they had not felt before. So the involvement of the citizens is absolutely number one priority. I hear in my travels people from other parts of the world sort of saying, ha ha, you Europeans thought you were the cat's whiskers, you see. For a long time, first you were colonists and you oppressed us and you got your riches out of our natural resources. That's where you grew rich and fat, and no wonder you're doing well. Well, now you see the other side of the coin. You're all on your own. Others have more riches. Others have grown economies that grow faster than you. And ha, 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 here you are. You see, you're going down the hill. And aren't we pleased to see that? I heard that from somebody later than yesterday, from a country I shall not name. The joy, if you like, that some feel in the fact that, well, Europe is going to the dogs. Whoever we is, and there may be many of them, even ISIL or somebody like that is going to have a holy war and actually, you know, wipe us off the surface of theirs. There are, alas, people who do not like what Europe has achieved. My personal feeling is that at least Europeans themselves should understand and appreciate what they have accomplished, even as, of course, we want them to be aware of what is wrong, just as Monet and Schuman saw the ghastly mess that Europe was in at the time they were writing this declaration. Europe, I saw it as a child. It was a hideous mess. It had killed millions and millions of innocent lives, both soldiers and civilians. The cities were destroyed and in ruins. People even in Great Britain, the head of the Commonwealth, were eating on food coupons for years. Travel restrictions were on and currency restrictions, etc., etc., etc. Europe was a mess and a ruin. In 1945 and for at least the 10 following years. It rebuilt itself, and the young people today count yourself blessed that you never saw anything of the kind, and pray to all your gods or to your whoever, or to your own convictions that you never have to see the sorts of things that there are still some alive, like from my generation, who saw how bad Europe could be. And if you think Europe is bad today, believe me, it's fantastic, it's terrific compared to what it once was.
I want to now ask President Prodi to chime in.
Everything is already been told, you know. And but I put myself from a different perspective. Let's say, Schuman Declaration had a specific purpose, a real clear goal, the creation of coal and steel community. And here you have a declaration that must be fitted to today's problems. Okay, the principles are clear. A general declaration against nationalism, let's say, a say in favor of more solidarity. But clearly, when you make the list, of the specific goals that say a passage from agriculture to urban culture. So you don't take account of a very simple situation, that the financial means are not sufficient to get these goals. When you have a budget that is 0.96 of European GDP, you can subtract from agricultural policy some euro, but then you cannot certainly change the situation of our city with existing money. And then it's difficult to have a common goal when there are this decentralized type decision, like, let's say, the transformation of our city is okay, is perfect, but it's difficult that you will mobilize new emphasis on the European rules on that. Second, energy. Clearly, we must link, we must have a common European energy policy. But even on that, we must have great ideas. In a situation in which we have an enormous overcapacity in gasification in Spain, and no possibility to transfer it in France, and we have no agreement of this problem, it's a political aspect that we have handled, you know, and have also some, let's say, great political proposals, you know. For example, in the last months, I went around different European leaders telling, look, we have this terrible problem of energy, why don't we make a joint company, one third Russian, one third Ukraine, one third European, and we manage the resources from Russia to Europe. And, you know, we work, give an idea of peace, give an idea of security, and we put things together. Everybody was in agreement. German Minister of Foreign Affairs, Putin, Italian Minister of Foreign Affairs, and so on. But you know, you have not the political passion to do that, you know. These are the proposals that change the feeling of Europe, you know, that makes Europe give you something absolutely new. And then defense and security. It was a very nice declaration, but 5 minutes after that, this was completely deleted from European purposes. So this is a very nice declaration, but we have to be more and more, let's say, strong and definitely on the political and financial means that are necessary to get that. You know, we must give the instruments to implement this declaration. And let's say what you mentioned, you know, we need the necessary solidarity to implement the ideas that are in this proposal. Then clearly we should analyze, but this is not part of the document. How can you do that in the enormous change we have in Europe in the last 10 years? When I was president of the European Commission, my motto about Europe was, the attraction of the new country was, Europe is a union of minorities. This was really the definition of Europe. And there was some equilibrium, you know, between Germany, France, UK. But now we live in a different Europe. We live in a different Europe. So we have to analyze how to handle this Europe in a situation in which we have not anymore a union of minorities. But you have a strongly leading country because of its virtues, not because of its vices, you know. But when you have a different situation, you have also to adapt, you know, this document and this piece to the changing of, to the change of the political situation. Thank you.
Giuliano.
It's not easy for the defendant to, but the point here is the following. All of us know which bold things should be needed to give the European Union the kind of tools and policies that are needed. We can't do several things we consider essential without giving the Union a budget of no less than 3-4% of the European GDP. It is so well known that it's here in not among the actions to be adopted immediately, but we say the disparity between the monetary and fiscal toolkit of Europe has to be faced unflinchingly, and its resolution has to be part of any medium and long-term strategy. The resources of the Union are incommensurate with its responsibilities, it is said. So we could repeat, we need it. But we know that nothing would happen now. Why? Because our leaders now are caught into a sort of 22 dilemma. What is needed is against what their citizens are ready to accept. Because nowadays, going around Europe and asking our citizens, are you willing to increase the common budget of the Union, our leaders don't even dare. So we have to think of, even though we need a bold leadership, our point was, let us ask a bold leadership what is reasonably predictable nowadays. And nowadays we say, something that might change the attitude of the citizens toward Europe and consequently give the leaders the courage of doing tomorrow what they don't feel they can do today. That's the point. That's why we say use the resources you have now, the social fund, to create that kind of threshold. It's something that in terms of consent of the citizens toward Europe can change attitude and can transform the no into yes. Start at least transferring part of the resources you give to agriculture to something else. And again, this can be taken seriously. If you don't have the courage not to stop Juncker when he speaks of common defense, but you realize that with your limited national budgets, you can't afford the necessary costs of defense, well, this is where your boldness, political boldness, now is needed. But honestly speaking, the process was this one. Concrete achievements today that might restore citizens' confidence toward Europe and strengthen somehow the political leadership in view of future action. This is what has inspired this kind of declaration.
It's a pleasure to welcome Danuta Hübner, who's the President of the Constitutional Affairs Committee of the European Parliament. Welcome, madam, and I give you the floor.
Professor, does it work? Because it doesn't sound like it's working. But I, first of all, I would like to thank you very much for bringing me here, because I remember back in 2007, 2008, Giuliana Amato just had a small group of people who were frustrated with the failure of the Constitution, and we were coming here and working on the new treaty for Europe. The drafter was also somebody from the Institute, and it's a great pleasure to be back here and again to see also that Giuliano has not forgotten about Europe. I was thinking what I can say at this stage of the, and I think that I would like to say why I like this document. I think it is a mixture of what Europe needs, which is certainly passion, and then a lot of pragmatism. I think this is something which today, to face all the challenges and to deliver what is expected, this combination is extremely important. And at the same time, this document, in fact, is combining two things which are usually difficult to combine. There are issues which we need to do to fix Europe, if I can say it shortly, but at the same time, this document is sending a message to citizens. And what is this message for me? My understanding is that linking it with what was said 65 years ago, when Europe was emerging from the ashes, and President Freiberger just described the major elements of the drama of those days. We were emerging from the situation and hoping for good, for better, for the change. And this linking the two things, in fact, is showing what is the most beautiful and the most valuable in Europe, which is that if we decide to act together, the unthinkable becomes inevitable. And I think this is what is, through this link, I think, achieved so well. The third thing I would like to say is that we sometimes forget that every generation, in fact, needs its own narrative about Europe. And from time to time, this discussion comes. Some of us do not like this idea of having a narrative. But I think it is important, because people, and especially this generation of social media, of ITC, people want to know what Europe is actually for them. And the normal perception in Europe, that's my experience, is among the citizens that Europe is an executive project. It is the government that goes there and does in Brussels the things which we call Europe. Nobody knows about European Parliament, basically. So it's all about governments. But governments never talk to people about Europe. So people are actually left alone with this challenge, which is Europe, which they don't really know what the Europe is for in their life. And that's, I think that's why this narrative, just making Europe sort of fit the current dreams or the current needs of new generations, this is something which is extremely important. And I like very much in your diagnosis, because I think there is a lot of elements of diagnosis of the situation in Europe, and behind all that is what you mentioned recently, Giuliano, what was in our discussion, is this lost confidence. I mean, everybody to everybody, everybody's confidence to everybody, nearly, and certainly confidence in Europe. And that's why I think this bringing back those big issues and saying what Europe is for is something which is very important. But I would like to ask you two questions, actually. One is related to this confidence building and to and to the major question which you just presented, which is how to make people get back to Europe. You mentioned the re-engagement of citizens, but you don't elaborate on it. I think this is today an extremely important issue, is how to re-engage citizens. We have this European Citizens Initiative, which is that people that you can collect, I'm selling it with some simplification, 1 million signatures, and then you can have impact on what the Commission will be doing in the future. So this need of having impact on what's going on in Europe, you can do it through this European Citizens Initiative. Very few went through, but 49 were presented. To get this initiative ready to be sent to Commission, you need 1 million signatures. That means that 50 million people at least, because some of them had more than 1 million, 50 million people in Europe, which is 10% of the European population, signed, they want to have impact, which I think is a lot. That's why this re-engagement and getting people on board is very important. I don't know if you, my question was, do you have any ideas on how you would see this re-engagement of people? That would be good to hear. But my second question, which I consider also important, is that we do all those, all of us do this reference to the Schuman who said that Europe will not be made at once. It's true, he said that it will be done step by step, and Giuliano also today has said step by step, but it's false, because in fact the whole Schuman Declaration, it's about vision. I mean, it just, every vision has to be realized. And we have been always avoiding this finalité politique in our discussions on Europe, and recently we all the time talk about step by step. Yesterday we had also Herman Van Rompuy, I was in panel with him, and he also said nothing big in the years to come, step by step, because we are in difficult situation. But if you again look at Europe, the biggest thing that happened to us was as always, with vision, with strategy, with a roadmap. And so I think, can you get passion, can you get that compassion, can you get people on board without a vision? I mean, I think it's, so what is this step by step, and don't we need today really a vision to get Europe back on track and to get citizens back into Europe? So that would be my second question. Don't we need a vision?
President Vika Friedberg.
I would say that the vision is there, but we've put on blinkers and we're not looking at it. First of all, because our political processes are focused on getting into power and keeping it, and quarrels between parties. And I know that speaking to lots of citizens in parts of Europe, they're fed up with the sort of the left versus the right, who is for the middle, who is for the citizen, never mind being left or right, what is the future and what is the vision. But we do have, the ideas are there, it's a matter of talking to people. Madam Huber, you're quite right. People people talk about their village, about their municipal elections, about their national elections, and when it comes to European elections, who talks to them? And I've heard in Latvia, for instance, people say, well, we send so few deputies to the European Parliament that it's hardly worth mentioning. All it means is we have a handful of people, we send them to Brussels and they get higher salaries than our deputies, our parliamentary deputies at home. They get a nice soft seat, and that's the end of it. That is not what Europe is about. And one has to talk to people. I remember going to Ireland shortly after Irish voters voted no to the then proposed constitution. And I was invited by a pro-European group and talked to them about why I feel excited about Europe and why my country felt that after over half a century under foreign occupation and an ideology which they did not choose voluntarily, they wanted the sort of setup that Europe had. And a gentleman, an old gentleman, came up to me and he says, I only wish you had come here to Ireland 3 weeks ago, and if you had explained to me what you now just today told us, I would have voted yes. But you see, I was hearing all sorts of things on the radio, that the Europeans would force us to have abortions, that the Europeans would ask us to do military service, that Europe was going to do all sorts of bad things. So we have, first of all, disinformation floating about, and for some reason we were being so coy and so democratic that Ireland has laws where the government can propose something to its people, but it cannot defend it. But people can come out with out-and-out lies and spread them in the newspapers and on the radio and the public media, and the people, when they hear propaganda, and we see it in other parts of the world today, when the media are controlled, when they're full of propaganda, the poor citizen hasn't got a chance. And then the question is, how do we communicate? Do we use the social media to terrorize our classmates and to gang up on people we don't like and to express all our bad feelings and our inferiority complexes and so on? Or can we use the social media for social change or for common action and for getting excited about things? I see a lot of non-governmental organizations. I remember the Semaine Sociale de France. I was talking to 3,500 people, committed volunteers in volunteer work for their country, but also helping and inviting people from the rest of Europe and the world. There's a lot of goodwill out there. It's a question of mobilizing. I think if citizens sometimes don't have enough faith in their leaders, leaders also sometimes lose faith in their citizens. I think citizens do have a fantastic potential. We have to reawaken that awareness that a lot of things are in their hands and they should not just sit there and complain about the elite, about those in power, about the bankers. Or I think the bankers should be, you know, spanked, a lot of them. But never mind, you know, what can we do about it? And I think there's a great deal. Starting by saying, is Europe a good thing or is it not? It's a rather harsh choice, but, you know, it's a start.
So, thank you. Last but certainly not least, our own Mr. Palka.
I would like to start by warmly thanking you for the possibility to speak in this distinguished circle. It's impossible to capture with words how great the honor it is. And I would like to congratulate the drafters of the document. I think it's a very good text. It's bold. It will be disputed, but I think at this moment it's necessary and important. And the question I wanted to ask is about the meta level of European values that you speak about the deep tissue of European axiology. For you, enlist values in the declaration as European values, rule of law, democracy, human rights, and solidarity. And these values will be necessary to achieve the aims which you enlist in your declaration, the aims that I personally endorse. Energy union, security and jobs, defense union. Those are important things to fight for, but they will be disputed. there will be people who will be against, for if we fight for them, there will be people who lose, so we might all gain together. So we need these values to fight for these aims, and the question I struggle with is, if those are the European values, why are they so? Why should we endorse those values? And at the first glance, it might seem like a bad question. I mean, why democracy, why human rights, why solidarity? It's obvious that democracy, human rights, and solidarity. But it has not always been so, and there might come a day, and I think we already see first signals that it's coming, that some people will come and say no to solidarity. We'll say, I'm not going to pay for them. We'll say, I don't want my people to die for them. And then I wonder if we're ready to give the answer to those people. For when we speak about the founding fathers, what certainly was a source of success of the European project was the post-war trauma, was the need to rebuild Europe. But there was also the positive thing they had behind them. They were committed to the values they preached, and they really believed in what they followed. They were committed Christian Democrats, they were committed Social Democrats, and they had an answer to saying why we should use these values, why we should follow them. And I'm not really sure if nowadays we have this answer as Europeans ready. Do we have this deep belief that we really should follow it, or have we just internalized it in our legal systems? Have we internalized it into the vocabulary we use while talking about Europe? But what would you say is the source, the axiological source from which we can derive today when difficult actions need to be taken based on difficult values?
If I may answer that one, I would say that Europe had become complacent while its economy was growing, and it was an economic giant and accepted quite happily to be even a political dwarf as opposed, say, to China or to the United States. When the crisis hit, and the financial crisis that we know started across the sea, but it's certainly the tidal wave, the tsunami hit us pretty hard, and my country certainly, among others, very hard indeed, and we had harsh, very harsh austerity measures before we got back on our feet. While things are going well, you can forget about beautiful principles. You say, oh, well, you know, practical life, everything is running nicely. Who cares about principles? I open a magazine, and what do I see in women's magazines? What is the it bag to be wearing today? So if our priority, or what is the watch that men should be wearing that is more expensive than the other watches, or what kind of extraordinary shoes should be women wearing? We've sunk into materialism, we've sunk into complacency, and the point is anybody in the schools talking about it? Do children debate about it in high schools? When I was a high school kid in Casablanca in a French school, you know what I was taught? I was taught about King so-and-so inherited his throne from so-and-so, and in such and such a year won such a battle or lost another one, and that sort of thing. And it's not until we came to the French Revolution that people as human beings even remotely came into the picture in the grand scheme of things. Europeans have step by step not just gained monetary free movement of capitals and whatnot and access to resources. Europeans have painfully over centuries developed these values. These are not cast in stone. We do not have our Moses who climbed up on Mount Sinai and who can claim, I got it straight from God, written with his own finger. We developed it. By Giordano Bruno burning at the stake and by the wars of religion and all the slaughters that went on for the Inquisition, with revolutions that turned into terror in France, in Russia. It has been a long battle. This is why history, first of all, should be taught in our schools, and also the feeling of what is human understanding, what is humanism that Europe has developed, because in other parts of the world, You have imams and you have madrasas and you have places where young people are getting excited about ideas, because when they're young and they're full of hormones and full of energy, they are looking for ideas. And if Europe is being deconstructed by those like Roland Barthes, who at one point said, well, when you are a good Marxist, what can you do to harm bourgeois society? You have to deconstruct it from within and sort of dispute all its values. Then we need an arena where people, those who look throughout history and saw that these values are precious and were bought in blood and in fire, then, and in suffering and in tears and in sweat. Those values, we, each generation has to make them own, and they have to have and not go out with torches like when the Nazis did, or not go out with the pleasure of cutting people's heads to make themselves feel important, but that they could feel what the accomplishments of Europe as a bastion of humanism, what they have inherited, what they can live with, and what they can hopefully even make much, much better. Because of course, it has to be much better.
So we come to the end of our first round, and in moments like this, when we in academic and intellectual environment are faced with these issues, the future of Europe, we can have agreement or disagreement of what needs to be done, what methods need to be done. But I'm always reminded of that great wisdom I learned from Altiero Spinelli. The easy road is to use our intellect to show all the reasons why these things cannot be achieved. But the difficult and challenging is to use our intellect in trying to show how a better future can be achieved. That was Altiero Spinelli's approach. We're now going to do the second round, and it's a challenge to our commentators, because one can agree or disagree whether it's useful to engage in the exercise of a, quote, new Schuman declaration. But I invite you to buy into the project. And imagine now that you're buying into the project, and you have one paragraph that you get to draft, one big idea that you would like to see that is not there. Now, you might have two or three, but I'm asking you to discipline yourselves and to focus on the one big thing that you think should have been there or you would have liked to be seen there and is not there. And mindful of the watch, I'm asking each one of the commentators to try and limit themselves to about 3 minutes to expose this one important idea that maybe our authors missed out. So I turn again to President Napolitano.
Well, first of all, I want to share the arguments of Madame Freiberger and of Giuliano Amato in explaining and defending the reasons and the character of this document. Of course, the idea was to speak to citizens, trying to inspire in them the sense of confidence, if not security, they have lost. And for this reason, I agree with Madame Hubner, we need to express passion and pragmatism. But it has been said, we have no card to play which is comparable with what the Schuman Declaration was able to say and to communicate. Even if I am allowed, we shouldn't over-evaluate the emotional impact on citizens that the Schuman Declaration had at the epoch. What was really inspiring for citizens was the fact of it itself, of seeing six heads of government sitting together and sign some common commitment. And then the follow-up, which were the plans of reorganization of coal and steel productions. That was more important, I permit to say, although I am an admirer of the Schuman Declaration, more important than the words of the Schuman Declaration. But coming back to what I could suggest, I want to suggest that the Declaration restates and reaffirms the necessity for an ever closer integration. This formula, which still is in the first article of the treaty, was put in question, badly put in question, as Giuliano Amato can remember, in the years of the convention, because at that epoch, that formula was even considered a threat for prerogatives of national states. It was common to hear a declaration of this type, but the national states will disappear if there will be an ever closer integration. And so there was also within the convention, I'm not speaking now of the Treaty of Lisbon, but even in the Constitutional Pact, a reflex of this defense of national competences. We cannot forget all this. But there has been a complete change in the situation as a consequence of the crisis, because all steps, all decisions which have been taken to face the crisis have gone unavoidably in the direction of an ever closer integration. What was the fiscal competence and other decisions and the banking union and so on. So we must have now the courage to say clearly to citizens, we need an ever closer integration, and we'll see what would be the outcome in terms of political union transcending national competences at last.
Determined to lay the foundation for an ever closer union among the peoples of Europe. Thank you, President Napolitano. Danilo Turk.
I would like to come back to the question of values, which I think is a very important, very valid question. And to explain that I don't see this document as a declaration, as a final pronouncement. As it was explained, this is an attempt to create a new narrative. And in fact, it needs further discussion. So it's not something final. And I believe that when a discussion is there, there is always a very wide variety of ideas that come. And of course, these ideas are also different in nature. The question of values is really a tricky one, because obviously there is a set of values one can easily identify without thinking too much, and the complacency of which President Freiberger has spoken comes into the discussion of values as well. Complacent with the fact that, you know, there is democracy, there is a certain level of rule of law, and you know, things in that regard don't look terribly problematic. So I think that when one talks about values, one has to be more specific. And I think that something of that nature is there in the document. What would I add as a paragraph? I would say, well, you know, if one talks about things like fiscal instruments, if one talks about common urban policy and things like this, this has to serve a purpose. And this has to strengthen the values upon which European integration is based. And those values have to be seen in terms of priorities of the day. Unemployment of young people is the most serious problem of European Union today. This is the problem that creates doubt, a problem which creates a huge doubt among young people regarding the future of the Union. It adds enormously to the crisis of confidence which nowadays exists. So if I was asked to add a paragraph, my proposal would be to focus on the question of employment opportunities for young people in the context of what is already there in this declaration. And let me make a comment also about the first Schuman declaration. I agree with President Napolitano that we should not overestimate the emotional and mobilizing effect of the declaration per se. Now, in retrospect, it looks great. And it is historically great because, unlike other European projects, it opted for a pragmatic approach which produced huge results. And that is why it is great, and that is why we are so impressed today. But then if we need to define with some degree of precision of what we mean when we talk about values, what we mean by solidarity, what kind of instruments are we going to employ to improve the situation, then I think we also have to be specific about the concrete priorities in policy making. And there is no greater, no more urgent task than reduction of unemployment and offering employment opportunities to young people. And I would put that most strongly in a single paragraph into the declaration.
Thank you. Professor Turk, youth unemployment. Calypso, what would your coal and steel be?
Well, I was thinking of who you are and who your audience is. And in a way, this conversation makes me think that maybe this declaration is a bit of a passage du bâton from mature generations to the new generation. And that means that really, what I read in the declaration as the core is very much this idea that veritable citizenship is not about moving, it's about the ability of citizens to own the polity. And that means that for me, your message is to expand on inclusiveness. Let's remember that Schuman's dad was born French, then in Lorraine, became German in 1871, and then became Luxembourger. And I think his son felt that, well, maybe not all Europeans had the fate of my father, but this inspires me to build a new Europe. And in that same sense, the question becomes, how can your text speak and be owned by the new generations? And how can you say more about this in the text, building on your very ideas? So, and for one thing, in this paragraph or in bits and pieces, I would really enforce and stress the fact that it is urgent to act long term, that the European Union has a comparative advantage in the long term. There is less elections and all this kind of thing. Maybe it's less democratic. And if the EU is the guardian of the long term, it's the guardian of the next generation, including the unborn. It doesn't want the burden of adjustment to be shifted to them. It wants to be able to link internal and external policies, because the world is shifting, we need to adapt. So that message, which I think is all about sustainable integration, I think fits very well with your emphasis on cities, with your emphasis on energy, with your emphasis on long-term safety, but needs to connect to make this a manifesto for the present, but about the urgency of the long term. And I would add that if you have this spirit, then definitely the new generations, my reading, and of course it's my students and others, and they're very much present here, we are EUI, is that the new generations are less Eurosceptics, but they're also less Eurocentric. They don't really like parochial Europe. So in that spirit, it's also necessary, I think, to stress, as was said earlier, including by Danilo, that your message is also about the world and about a Europe that is indeed less Eurocentric than it's been. And finally, on this emphasis on the new generation, I would ask the question of the how of ownership. And you do, but I would say it's not sufficient. To say that, you know, EP elections should be different is not enough. Can you not signal the fact that the mature generations embrace a new world, a virtual world, a world of social media, a world where we're going to be doing politics more and more differently, and that Europe can do politics more and more differently. Vira, you always make fun of me when I speak of Agora Europe, a Woodstock of European politics, but indeed, European politics should be more of a Woodstock, be it virtual or real, and that's also why we're here together today.
So thank you, Calypso. Citizenship as ownership of the polity, but more detail on how that can be done in our contemporary democracy. President Prodi.
Well, everything has already been told, you know, and I have nothing to add, you know, because the real question, it was put by Talila, how to engage citizens, and we already had the answer. We could make additional requests, you know, what Danilo
told on youth unemployment is perfect, but the real problem is that when we translate these goals in real policy, we shall find such a difference among the states that is impossible to translate in action. So I think that we have to follow what Giuliano told in his last intervention, that we have to be patient, we have to be conscious of the limits of the budget, we have to enlarge resources, and we have to have a manifesto that cannot be organized in one goal, but to reverse step by step the situation. So certainly this is not a revolutionary work, but is what can be done today. This is the limit of my of the problem is that as my Chinese students asked me when I tried to explain the complicated situation of Europe and how we have to change the situation, that this is the best laboratory, political laboratory in the world, that we need time and so on. The young student asked me, Professor, but Europe is a laboratory or a museum? Because they wanted action. But I understand, Giuliano, that now is impossible to have that. So we have to be happy to have an update museum.
So a sense of realistic priorities. President Hübner, you've got a paragraph.
It's not yet written, but I would just like to say that I remember before we joined in 2004, before this big bank enlargement, in which I was strongly involved, I was always using this sentence from the Schuman Declaration when he says that all Europeans without distinctions from the West and from the East, I was always saying that Schuman already at that time was saying, keep the doors open, those guys are on the other side of the river, but one day they will come. And that's why I would like to propose open Europe. I think I would like to take us also outside, and we have been extremely introverted over the last years. After 2004, we had as Europe, I think, to see that it works, and then the crisis hit, you know, other crisis, the war across the border and the migration and the terrorism, very messy world, and we continue to be introverted. We continue to work on how to make Europe function better, and there is a risk that we will go on with this for far too long, and we, the enlargement policy used to be the most powerful European policy, if you think of what we got to Europe, the sheer size plus all the rest, through enlargement. We certainly failed, I think, on transforming the neighborhood into geopolitically harmonious part of European continent and North African continent. So I think we have to understand that there is a lot to do outside there. And I'm saying this open Europe and in terms of enlargement neighborhood and more, I'm saying that because I think there is a risk that with all the threats, including the migration, which is seen as a threat by many of us in Europe, there is this risk that we will be identifying Europe, we will be looking for our identity against the rest of the world, and not identity, European identity on the basis of what is uniting us, including the openness, but what is uniting us in, when we defend ourselves against all the aggressions. So this openness, I think, in terms of to the world, but also this openness in terms of citizens, society really being open to live in the diversity, and this is something which I consider very important. I hope you can make out of it a tiny paragraph, but I think it's important.
Thank you. So the last word to this new generation.
Thank you very much, President. Let me then, as a member of the new generation, confirm the claim of Professor Kalib, a little bit less Eurocentric. For as much as I really enjoyed the document, what I found a lot inside was Europe. But what I didn't really see was other places in the world, like China, like India, like US, like Brazil. Not necessarily as a threat to us, but just as a presence, and say, in the positive meaning of the word, competitors. So other places that do what we do, trying to grow, trying to progress. And I think what I would stress is, in the historical term, showing how this is the moment we have to unite, for there is a chance that we can miss. And it's a perfect place to make this claim, here in Italy, here in Florence. And that is the theme that came coming up during the last year's State of the Union conference. If you think of Italian cities in the 15th century, of Florence, of Bologna, of Venezia, that was the peak. Culturally, financially, they were the power. And yet, they failed to unite when they had time to unite, and in the centuries to come, for bad or for good, for they didn't colonize, they were not the players in the world. And I would stress this very similarity, that it will be difficult to unite in some spheres nowadays, but maybe if we think in the long term, and maybe if we look around at the whole world, there is a chance that we do not want to miss in this.
Before I invite Sandro Gozi, the Italian State Secretary for European Affairs, to make some concluding remarks, I want to give Giuliana Amato and Vaira Vika Freiberga the opportunity to leave us. What's the last thing you want to leave us with? Very brief.
I have to be brief because I have to leave, and I apologize for this. But let me say two things. I get the last point. The Schuman Declaration had a passage on Europe being united can do something for Africa. Yes. It was a passage, and we ignore Africa, which is a different thing, but it's Europe in the world. This is something that really is needed. As to the difference between museums and the future, Mano, I would only say the following, that if I want to restore the sense of the future in citizens that are rejecting Europe as the source of a better future, I have to eliminate the door, the wall, that stands between my vision of the future and their vision of their present, and the relationship between their present and the future. One thing that I have to do that is missing in the document, I had it in mind, was relying more on the Erasmus generation, because the Erasmus generation is immune from the old hostilities that these difficult times have restored among the old generations of Europeans. And this is something. But considering the others, my job, in my view at the moment, is not describing the beauty of the future, but finding the key that can open the door that stands between many of my fellow citizens and this future. If I open the door, I can drop the keys, and they will find themselves in that future again. Having said so, allow me to leave, Joseph, because I have to do it. Goodbye.
I would say that when we were writing this report, we could feel the rest of the world breathing down our necks every moment. But to enter into detail about just what that means, that would be in a different declaration. You may look up the European Council of Foreign Relations scorecard on the foreign policy of Europe, and I think Calypso and I were involved in that as well. I think you will find there some interesting remarks about where Europe stands in the relation to certain big areas or specific countries of the world. My own feeling as somebody who left Europe as a child of refugees at a time when Europe was full of refugees from communism, from Eastern Europe, and I think there were 7 million of them. Now we're talking about the ones that are drowning in the sea. I have relatives who also were trying to cross to Sweden, and many, many people drowned in the Baltic Sea trying to get to Sweden as an island of peace while their country was in flames, and one occupation was being replaced by another. Europe at that time, people may not remember that. There were 7 million of us, and Europe kicked us out. So when today you hear complaints that Europe is not taking everybody in, believe you me, I'm one of those who was born a European and was kicked out of it as a refugee because there was no place for me or mine in that Europe. So we've gone a long way, believe you me. For instance, the refugee policy of Sweden is dramatically different today from what it was at the end and after the war. Europe frequently gets nowadays, I think, bogged down in what Madame Hubner talked about the executive part, and I think President Napolitano also talked. Europe is a sort of, there's the Commission, there's the Parliament, and there's a lot of debate, shall we do this, that, or the other? Should chickens lay 5 eggs a week or 7 eggs a week? How high their cages should be? Can cucumbers be straight or can they be crooked? And endless details that are exceedingly trivial, unworthy of our attention, and that should have been left, I think, to the flow of time and actually spontaneous solution among people. What Europe has been neglecting, it's been so busy in the small details and also in the party quarrels. You open a French newspaper and say so-and-so is becoming more popular than somebody else. Mr. X said such and so, which has been criticized, and Mr. Y or Madame Y has been praised. We are being bogged down into the mechanics of politics and the mechanics of practical life, so that even the grandiose vision of coal and steel, that was in a sort of grand style as opposed to so much of what currently preoccupies Europe. And I think we would, my own feeling, there's one thing I would recommend the younger generation is don't get stuck looking at your feet and into the mud in your feet, but look up into the sky and into the stars and think of what your ideas and your goals would be for your life and for your descendants. We need to sort of raise our faces from the mud to up into the sky.
So I invite now Sandro Gozi, the Italian Secretary of State, to make some concluding remarks. Si, welcome.
Thank you, and good evening to everybody. I would like first to thank Professor Weile, to thank all the discussants, and to thank the authors of this very significant document, because as a member of a government of the European Union, I think that all has been written and all that has been said is certainly very, very inspirational. And as I'm a pioneer of the Erasmus generation, as I've done the Erasmus program just a few months after the fall of the Berlin Wall. I fully recognize in the remark that the last remark that Giuliana Mato and Vaira Vicke Freiberga has done, notably about the need of a new commitment. And I think that for an Erasmus generation it's much easier to feel fully committed about Europe, about European values. It is difficult to do concluding remarks. I would like to try to show the golden thread that there was in your discussion, and because there was, in my view, a clear golden thread. But certainly, laboratory or museum. I'm not a scientist. I prefer the laboratory, of course, but if it must be a museum, I hope it is at least a museum of contemporary art, of modern art, with some futurism probably inside, and that would certainly already a positive step forward. You mentioned that it was 65 years ago. You all mentioned that Schuman was right, that Europe hasn't been done all at once, but through concrete achievement, which created a factor of solidarity. You all mentioned explicitly or implicitly this. Certainly, after the first pedal of 1950, this bicycle has been riding ups and downs, and with accelerations and halts. It is true that in the last 10 years, as the French say, nous avons eu les nez dans les guidons. We have been struggling in making this this cycle run. But you mentioned two words, and it's very interesting. You mentioned the word vision, and you mentioned the word solidarity. Now, I even said it yesterday in Milan. I'm still struck by the fact that when I was talking about vision and solidarity with some, with a member of another government in the European Union a few months ago, and I was, as you, stressing the need for vision, right? We need a vision, we need to relaunch the project. The answer of my colleague was, well, if you need a vision, if you have vision, go to see a doctor. It is not of vision what we need concrete stuff. What we need in our document is concrete stuff. And of course, I agree with you. I think that we need vision, but certainly I don't know if this colleague was a member of Erasmus generation. I hope not, because in that case it hasn't worked, the Erasmus generation. But this is the kind of mood that we had to fight against. And all you said was going in this direction, to fight against this mood, because it is clear that Europe needs a vision of itself and also needs a vision of the world. The issue of Eurocentric, being less Eurocentric. So that's certainly something that we have to work on, and I'll come back in a few minutes later on this. The other word you use is solidarity, which was not only a word which was used in the Schuman Declaration, solidarité de fait, but it is a word which is mentioned at least 21 times in our treaty. 21 times the word solidarity is mentioned in our treaties. There aren't 21 policies which promote solidarity within the Union. So it is clear that we are very far from what it is mentioned in the treaty, and certainly we need to convince. That another word you use, which is very important, it's a word that every politician uses to convince. Why Europe does not convince the citizens anymore? And probably we have to come back to the etymology of the word to convince, which derives from Latin, which is cum vincere, which means winning together. So probably what we have to say to convince citizens is that the only way we can win together, because there are challenges, there are threats, as you said, and to face these challenges and to win these threats, we can win together. Now, it is clear that to win together, you need solidarity. And it is also true that in these years, Europe has forgot solidarity, because the debate, the European debate, has been organized about a fictitious contract, a fictitious and vicious conflict between debtors and creditor countries, between those who lend the money and those who borrow the money. it is clear that this is something very far from European values, very far from the Robert Schuman Declaration, and also very far from the idea of winning together. It is not like that, that you can win together. So it is clear that one of the issue you mentioned, the issue of the governance, of the new governance, of the new economic governance, it must be faced, and we are working at the Italian government with some contribution to this end, it must be faced through resource and risk-sharing policies. A new approach on resources, it has been mentioned, it is true, and a new approach also to risk-sharing policies. Because it is clear that we need new risk-sharing policies around the euro, otherwise you cannot have a truly economic policy, otherwise you can develop a social dimension, but this idea around risk-sharing has been forgotten, because, I mean, very few has been done on the solidarity side. But some step ahead, European Stability Mechanism is a form of solidarity. We have to build upon this, and it came very, very late. What I mean, it is that there is no mutual trust anymore among us Europeans. We don't trust each other anymore. Governments do not trust each other anymore. Peoples do not trust each other anymore. This is why I insist it is important to work around the idea of solidarity. This is why it's important to work around the idea of new common objectives. Starting, for example, as you say, from the euro. Because we have to shift from the idea of what we need, for example, during the crisis, what we have done. We have done necessary things. But the new instrument have all been introduced around the logics, I need to control you better. I need to control you better because I don't trust you fully. So I need instrument to control you better. It is clear that we need mutual surveillance. It is certainly true. We need mutual surveillance to develop responsibilities. And it is true that some governments haven't been acting in a responsible manner over the years. But it's also true that you cannot build a new political union, a new union, if you work around the idea of responsibility and you forget solidarity. Responsibility and solidarity must go in hand, otherwise Europe walk with the limp. And if you walk with the limp, you cannot win the global marathon that we are, as Europeans, we have to win. So to work around the issue of mutual trust, starting also by introducing, you mentioned unemployment, you mentioned youth unemployment, some of you mentioned the social dimension, it is mentioned in the treaty. A European unemployment insurance scheme, it is something that we have to work on if you want to develop a truly governance around the euro through social policies. This is a concrete example of what I mean of combining responsibility and solidarity through new policy proposals. The other issue, which I mean, you have said everything, and I couldn't say it better. The issue of values, but there is something there. It is true that we cannot miss this chance, and it is true that there is a threat to our security, which citizens feel as a threat to their social security, but also to their life security. The issue of terrorism, Charlie Hebdo, and everything has moved around that. I think that, however, to be consistent and to relaunch also our values by giving concrete answer, which only Europe can give, to the new threat to security, you have to develop policy which ensure your right to security, and it is true that Europe can show its added value by developing new policies to ensure the right to security. You have said everything in the paper, internal, to go beyond the notion of internal and external security, the new security. We hope that some answer will be given in the security strategy which the Commission will present to the European Council in June. But the right to security must go hand in hand with the security of fundamental rights, with the new policy of the rule of law, with a new policy of prevention of gross and risk of gross violations of fundamental rights within the Union. This is why we have been working very hard during the semester of the Italian presidency to convince the Council to start, and we will start this year for the first time, a debate every time it is necessary, but at least once a year, about the state of the rule of law and the state of fundamental rights within our union. These two things must go together. We have to bring down this hypocrisy wall according to which we screen the democratic ADN of the candidate countries, and then when a country from candidate becomes member, they are black box and we don't look into them. And this is something that we have to do. This is something that is fully consistent with what you said in your paper. The other word you mentioned, and I fully agree, the issue of demography. If there is something that we can only win together, and about is something around which we can convince the European citizens, is demography. Because it is clear that to face the demographic challenges, the European Union hit the minimum level playing field. Minimum. Of course, then cooperation with other countries, with other countries. But the minimum level playing field around which we can address the issue of demography is Europe. And many aspects of the current European debate are organized. They do not know, probably. We are not conscious, we are not aware. But they are caused by the challenge of demography. Welfare debate, health debate, immigration debate, economic and political populism is mainly organized about the lack of answer that we give to the demographic challenge we are facing in the European Union. And this is something on which we have to work through economic policy, through social policy, by giving structural answer to the issue of asylum and immigration. The unsolved and unmanaged demographic issue is a real fuel in the engine of the new political and economic populism, in my view. Before to conclude, the other thing is trust. And I think that it's very true. We are convinced, and this is something which I share with some other members of the Italian government, that the moment to verify the confidence of the citizens is the election, the political election, is at the time where you can verify whether you have done a good job or a bad job. But we don't have to ask to the citizens every day to trust us. We have to show that we trust them. And this is why the issue of confidence is a fundamental issue for the action of any government, but mainly for something which is felt far, wrongly perceived far from the daily life of citizens as European Union. It's the Union which must show that it trusts the citizens before asking the citizens to trust the Union. And this is why we have to get rid of a logic which has proved useful in the past, but cannot be used anymore, of Europe as a useful external constraint. It has been useful. In my country, it has been very useful. Today, we cannot use the issue, the idea of Europe as a useful external constraint. We have to fully embrace the logics of Europe as multiplier of rights and of opportunities. In my view, this is the new narrative that we have to follow, to persuade, and to convince the citizens around the need of Europe and the need of an ever closer union. This was very important. And it is true there are still some governments around in Europe that raise all the time this issue. We have to get rid of the phrase ever closer union. Of course, we cannot get rid of the phrase ever closer union because it's a free choice. We do not oblige anybody to go toward the direction of ever closer union, but many of us have freely chosen to go along that way. Of course, we have waited 65 years. We don't have other 65 years to wait. I would like to see fully realize all this in 65 days. if we take some positive step in 650 days, I would be pretty satisfied and pretty happy. Thank you very much.
Mille grazie. I want to thank you all. I want to thank Mr. Gozi, President Vika Flybelga, our distinguished commentators, and of course all of you in the audience, and to invite everybody present. We've had food for thought and now food for our stomach in the loggia of the European University Institute. Thank you all.